Okay, tonight we are going to go over our 2018 and 2019 seasons, look at how the design process sort of went through with those two robots. Both of these got much closer to our the same design process that we used in 2020. We were like doing weekly reviews. Our sub-team splits were much closer to how they are now. A lot of how we were doing SolidWorks is very similar. A lot of it is adapted and kind of grown. But we've kind of had our design process down for the whole robot. Largely the same for the last three seasons, where before that it was a mix of a bunch of stuff and it never really worked. Why the CAD for those robots are also not nearly as complete. Okay, so we're going to look at 2018 first. We can see it how the robot actually went. So this is the robot that our first regional win happened in 2018. All right, so we have the highlight video from 2018. Yes, we had a full wooden prototype. The power-up game was basically who had ownership of the scale and the switches. We were trying to back and forth. So looking at that robot and kind of the design concept. So we had to be able to hang at the end, and then you basically had to be able to pick up these cubes and put them in the different scoring objects, the two switches, which are the low ones, your own and your opponent's, and the center scale. And you got the most, and you got points for however long it was tilted to your end of the field. We do have the CAD. I'm gonna go ahead and switch over to SolidWorks. And while I'm doing that, so that's the CAD of the full robot. I'm gonna find something on Drive real fast because I realize I can pull up some of the design reviews from that year too. The design slides. Oh, we had those. Maybe we don't have those. Maybe we only have 2018. Okay, we'll just look at the CAD. So we have the full, the actual full robot with largely all of its parts. A lot of the electronics are hidden, just so it doesn't try to crash SolidWorks or anything, but on the belly pan were the powder fusion panel. The Robo Rio was mounted vertical somewhere in here on a little sheet metal bracket that seems to not be opening CAD right now either. And then there were a few of the speed controllers for the drivetrains. It got like tucked away in this corner, like the Talon SRXs were all stacked up over here, which led to some wiring issues. And then all of the rest of the speed controller, basically for everything going on in the arm and the intake, were actually inside these A-frames. That was not intentional when we initially ran the design. We just ran out of belly span room to make it nice, and because the wiring had to go up anyway, we were able to adapt them a little bit and drill some holes to allow us to mount 2 to 3 speed controllers in each one of these little like boxes that we had built. So it was a happy accident that worked out very cleanly and very nicely. A little annoying if we ever had to replace one. I don't think we didn't have to do it very often. And even once you did, it wasn't too bad. These little like side panels were here that often weren't even like, we kept them off a lot of the time, so you could get in and do stuff if you needed to. Okay, so overall, when we were looking at this game and trying to figure out how we were going to play it, we were a little hesitant to try to like be a scale dominant robot. We weren't sure if that made sense. We didn't know that we like kind of like just playing out the game and how we thought the game was going to be played. We weren't necessarily sure that you needed 2 robots playing the scale the whole match. Was partly our kind of design philosophy because there were so many points to be had by winning your switch and your opponent's switch. So we kind of assumed, okay, if we can be reasonable at the scale, but then very good at the switches, that would be very important, offloading some of the work that the, if we can be better at the switches than like the other scale bots could be, maybe that would give us some advantage. That was partly our train of thought. That train of thought was wrong. That's like key takeaway from 2018 was being good at the scale was more important than anything else, and having multiple robots be good at the scale was important as well. There were a few teams who could hold the scale on their own against a lot of people, but you just didn't want to, and you're still basically, when you were drafting, if you were a captain and you could do the scale, you were still drafting a second robot that was largely handling the scale and doing some work on the switches, but it was very hard to get that big of an advantage scoring into the low switches over by being small or having an arm or anything that we did over just a robot with an elevator that could do the scale too. They're just largely as good or better than even we were. Part of our thought was that we wouldn't have to spin around from like the far feeder station to go into the opponent switch. There was some thought that we would just like grab the cube out of it and then flip the arm over and score it. We're driving very little, just kind of forward and backwards. That cycle never really existed through some lack of practice on our part. And also it just wasn't really necessary. It was easier and most of the time timed faster for the cube to already be on the ground, us to spin around, grab it from the floor, spin back around and score it, than it was to even flip the arm. Like, we never quite got the arm fast enough to where it made any sense to do that. There were definitely times where the arm came in handy. We got pushed off a defender or something and we could still flip over and score on the back. It was valuable on occasion, definitely not valuable enough to design the whole robot around. Like any redesign of 2018 robots absolutely should just be an elevator. And I think we fell into a trap of overthinking the game when we knew that the best robot in the world would be an elevator. We still didn't build that robot, and that's silly. Okay, so looking at what we did build and things that did make some reasonable sense. So our drivetrain that year strayed away from our normal drivetrain plans. It was still sheet metal, but it ends up looking like a robot that not a lot of people have ever built before. There's a lot of reasons why. It's not exactly the lightest. It's not even really space constrained. It's not space efficient all that much. Basically what it ends up being is an inverted West Coast. So these outer tubes that are basically sheet metal boxes. Let me see if we can isolate so we can see how they're bent. So you have the outer rail. It's largely a normal sheet metal rail. Like, we've used this shape a lot where you just have a flat plate with 4 flanges around it. But then we had to have bearings because we are live axle. Because the wheels aren't between the plates, so there's no good way to do dead axle. We're having to transfer the torque from the sprockets that are between the plates to the wheels that are inside in our version, since it's what we call an inverted West Coast. The wheels are on the inside. So you have this sprocket here that has to be driven to a hex shaft, and that hex shaft is what actually drives the wheel on the inside here. In this case, all four of the wheels are Omni wheels, which we'll get to in a second on why we did that. So the inner rail looks similar. I think it has a little bit bigger flanges. Yeah, so it's a little bit wider. So we have room for both sprockets inside of it, because we were still running 35 chain, so this had to be pretty large. So this is, let's see, it's like, yeah, it's like 166 there. When you add in the flange on the other side, you get to almost 2 inches. So it's a pretty big tube that we built. It's also, what, it's like 4.25 tall. So it's rather tall, you know, almost four by two, basically, sheet metal that we turned into a box extrusion. So it's really large for not a lot of reasons. We did lighten it. The whole outside is triangles cut into it, makes it a little bit lighter, but still not efficient as it could have been. Right, teams that do this out of a normal West Coast, you do it out of a 2x1, you can make it a lot lighter than if you're doing something like we did. I guess now is the time to talk about the wheels. So yeah, so it was all Omnis. This was taken, we had done, like you've been around for all of our other design reviews so far, back in 14, you know, we basically ran most of the season on all Omnis. We had the ability to push down the traction wheels, and we rarely used them because of rocking and some other stuff, but we drove most of the season in all Omni, and it worked quite well. 3310 is another strong proponent of the all Omni drive. Their 2017 robot was all Omni. I believe their 18 robot was. I'd have to go double check that, but I'm pretty sure it was as well. Largely, the all Omni idea is that you don't need to be put into, you don't need to hold your ground sideways very often, where if somebody pushes you from the side, if you're all on Omnis, you're just going to get shoved over to a wall and there's going to be a pin count started. And then you're free, or you're able to turn off of them, get away from them, because you don't have that scrub. It's very hard to get friction pinned in the middle of the carpet, which is whenever you see somebody pinning somebody from the side and then kind of doing that whole big spinning in a circle thing. You can hold what isn't a pin, but because you're, both robots are moving, so they're not really pinned, they're moving a pretty good distance, but the offensive robot has no control over where they're going, basically, if you can do it right. You can get them spinning in a circle for a long time. But you can't do that with Omni, since you just get pushed to a wall instead of being able to hold the friction in the middle of the field. So partly it's an idea to basically be a full offensive robot. You don't really want to be defensive very often, since you also can't stop anybody. If you're driving side to side, they can just push you away. So it's not very good for defense, but this isn't a game where you're going to be playing defense very often. And if you are, you just have to make sure you're playing it with the front of your robot and you're pushing somebody else. The Omni will still get pretty good traction. You're able to push other people. You just can't like stop sideways very easily with just the Omni wheels. What we did add into the design, or and eventually did add into the robot, were these guide rod pneumatic cylinders that would push into the ground and act as brakes. So there'd be traction material mounted here, and these would push into the ground, taking quite a bit of the weight of the robot onto them, and preventing us from being able to be pushed sideways. So if we wanted to play defense, basically, or we wanted to just stop in the middle of the field, we could choose to do that using the pneumatics. And those worked okay. We never had any bends on them or anything. The biggest disadvantages are they're pretty heavy. I want to say total, they're a little over 5 pounds together, which is definitely not light. By the end of it, we did have the weight for it, so it was fine. And we had them on there. They weren't used super often, but when we needed them, they were mostly effective. But yeah, they are big. They take up space. They take up a decent amount of air, so you have to make sure you have enough air on your robot to actually run them if you're cycling them in any frequency during a match. So the rest of the drivetrain that we did not talk about is our gearbox. So we did run a 6 mini sim, 2 speed gearbox, one on each side. If you watched our 2016 design review, this gearbox should look relatively similar, the kind of plate geometry and shape. It's basically the same gearbox, but we were able to remove a stage and get the motors directly driving the two input gears into the shifting gears. We're not going to go into the details of how the ball shifter works. We've already done a video on that. So hopefully, if you haven't seen it, go back and watch that. But the ball shifter, again, allows us to have two different speeds. Off the top of my head, I don't remember what they are. I believe they were pretty fast. I think low was somewhere around 10 or 11. Might have been a little higher. And then high was like 16 or 17, somewhere in there. So we were pretty fast. We knew that some points we'd have to get across the field pretty quickly. Like if we were working on one switch, we wanted to be able to drive almost the full length of the field to the other switch if we needed to get back over there and protect our home switch or something like that. This gear here is what's known as an idler gear, since all it does is transfer power from this motor into the gear stage going the rest of the way, right? Without this gear, this motor doesn't help provide any power. And this gear and shaft don't transfer power anywhere else. They just provide it back into this pinion. Sometimes when you do this, some teams will support the other end of this shaft. So you could put a bearing here or something, because you do get, this gear is now loaded twice, right? Normally the pinion's only driving like this one gear, but it has another gear here, so it's getting a lot more force put on it. As long as they're directly in a straight line, it's less bad than if there's any sort of angle to it, because the forces kind of even out, right? You have one force going down on this side, you have the other one going up on this side, and it doesn't really want to bend the shaft at all. If you were to have these two gears, the center line of these two gears like below or above this pinion, and you kind of move them in at the arc where everything's still mated right, but now you had like kind of different forces on it, they don't all even out, you can do weird stuff to where you start, this shaft gets forces acting on it in weird ways where it starts to bend, which you don't want. So then you definitely need to have something supporting this end of the shaft, another bearing mounted to a plate or something. But here it worked fine. We ran it the whole season. I don't believe we ever supported the other end on this robot. Let's see. This was set up in CAD to be able to do in-motor cooling. I'm not sure if we ran it on these mini sims ever. But there is a system that you can look up on, like Chief has some post about it. And now the Falcon is designed for it. There's even a port. Basically, you can run air into the motor through one of the bolt holes, and then the other one, you have a vented bolt so that the air can come out. So if you need to cool your motors, you can actually run compressed air through them, either from your pneumatic system or through like a can of compressed air or through an offboard compressor or stored air, whatever you want. So it's not air being used on the robot to like actually do anything during a match. If you're just doing it after matches, if the motors get hot, you can do that. It's way less important now they're at brushless motors. The Falcons and the Neos stay way, way cooler than the mini Sims and Sims ever did, just because they're so much more efficient. They're not generating nearly as much heat and wasting a lot of energy. They turn that energy largely into mechanical power that we can use on the robot. The last little bit, like I said before, it's 35 chain, like almost all of our drivetrains are. We'll see the counterexample to that in 2019. Each of these going, 12th tooth to 32, so the final reduction. Ideally, had we figured out some version that would have kept this sprocket up higher and not having to have these cutouts in the flanges, it probably would have been better. They were built, they did have the full, they had a flange on it, but it wasn't quite deep enough, so this like gets bent kind of oddly. Since we're bending all the way across it, let me see if we can isolate that again. if SolidWorks doing. There it goes. Yeah, so our sponsor is able to bend something like this because they can clamp here and here and bend this, even though they wouldn't normally be able to bend the same part because there's no way they could actually clamp this and get it in the V-die. What that means, though, is this is probably not going to come out flat. We didn't really care, right? So on the real one, if you look at it, part of this, instead of kind of being bent at a full 90, starts dipping down a little bit. That doesn't do anything to our design. So we just told them to bend it and it came out fine. But it's definitely not going to be it's not going to look perfect in real life like it does in CAD, just because that's not how the brake works. Okay. Any questions on the drivetrain from that robot? I don't think we would ever do anything like this again. I'm still not why we did it the first time. I'm still not entirely sure. Like, we'd have to go back and really look at what we were doing. It was not planned. We kind of actually built awkwardly. We built the wooden prototype and just kind of built the frame out of 2x4s first, and mounted wheels in there so that we'd be able to move it and mounted them in this configuration because it was easier to put them inside when we had the 2x4 frame going all the way around. And realized we kind of liked it for bumper mounting and for a few other things. But there was no real reason to do it, right? There's no reason why this couldn't have been either a normal West Coast drive if we wanted to do it out of tube, if we had the ability to like route tube or something, or some version of a sheet metal West Coast like 148 is known for doing a few years ago. Or even just our normal parallel plate drivetrain as well. Like we were trying to get some more belly pan room. I think that was part of it, which this did accomplish for our design purposes, right? There's more room between these two rails than there would have been had we done a normal drivetrain when we have like 3 or 4 inches between our two sheet metal plates, which does help a little bit. It spreads out our motors a bit more, right? So the back of this mini sim is closer to the edge of the robot than it would have been had we done our normal parallel plate drivetrain. So some of those all went into the decision to do this compared to any of the other drivetrains, and it did work. It was fine. It's probably a little heavier than things we could have done. There's probably another way to make the same style inverted West Coast with it taking up less space and less weight than we did. Yeah. Okay. Last thing, it did have our normal 6mm Baltic birch wooden belly pan. So this just gets done on the router that year, but would have been done on the laser now. And then just riveted into the bottom. This provides a lot of stiffness to the entire square structure, so we can't twist it at all because you have this nice wooden panel running the whole length of it. Let's see. Okay. If there aren't any questions there, we'll then look at the A-frame. So this whole robot was inspired by a lot of the other, I don't know what to call them, low pivot arm bots, which is basically oftentimes known as a pink arm. Pink popularized this design concept through their, going all the way back to, I think, 7. Might even been before that. But multiple of their robots throughout the years have basically a relatively low pivot arm that then has a telescoping tube that their intake collector, whatever it is on the front of it, is built on. And then they're almost always able to reverse in some way to kind of work the same forward and backwards, so the whole thing can swing through the robot. So in our case, the intake can be either on this front or on the back, and it can flip over. As we were going through the design concept, one of the things we wanted to make sure we did was only have a single stage on the inside of the arm. And that was one of the driving factors of us even ever committing to this plan, was we didn't want to have a double telescope or anything. We weren't sure the best way to have to do some of the routing. We'll get to the telescoping here in a second. But we were trying to avoid that at all costs. So we were able to do that by kind of how we designed some of the A-frame and how we designed this inside part to allow the back of this arm to come really close to the bottom of this belly pan. I have to find it again, but it's within 3 inches, I think, at some point. Like, it is very, very close. And so part of that ended up being how we made and mounted the A-frame structure. So we relied quite heavily on Solarcraft for this robot, right? This is probably the most sheet metal robot we've ever done. This one in 2014, probably. Where this was multiple sheet parts. Let me actually open, let's see if I can isolate the A-frame. Okay, yeah, so each of the A-frames are they're symmetrical in both directions, right? So this one can replace the other one and you can flip it 180 and it still works the same. There are quite a lot of parts to them. The part count on this is pretty numerous. Like if you look up here, there's this internal piece that is actually hard to see sometimes. I'd have to exit isolate to re-isolate. Maybe. Yeah, so this is this top part, which is hard to even see with everything wrapping around it, is this tiny little sheet metal part in here that gets the flanges all bent on the sides, and they come in with a die that is smaller than this width, and they bend up this flange here, and they do the same thing again over on this side. And so these aren't 90, so you have to make sure SolidWorks is calculating everything properly with K-factor, so it's actually able to bend properly. This is gonna get awkward. It's like upside down. Let's throw it back over. Okay. So there's that internal part, and then at the top, there are two of these parts that are the same. So this one and the one on the backside are the same, and they help mount the rest of the A-frame pieces to that top part. And we wanted to make sure the top part was very strong and wasn't gonna bend at all, since it was gonna take the full weight of the arm all the way up here. So we did a lot of reinforcing to make sure this was gonna be strong enough. Then the next main part of all of this are these bottom and top pieces. I'll actually do isolate on these because these get kind of weird looking. So there's kind of weird Z bend to where they goes all the way to the bottom, has the mounting holes to mount into the belly pan and the front and back rails of the whole robot. And then coming up, it has some lightning patterns going through it. In places there's like zip tying for wires, and we ended up actually being able to drill holes into here for the speed controller mounting. So luckily we had the gap right to where these webs allowed for bolts to be mounted for the speed controllers. And then these bolts here ended up actually having standoffs on them. I don't know if got catted. It doesn't look like they did, but they ended up actually being bolted through for this pillow block, which we'll get to as we start talking about the arm. Basically, to secure the arm to the whole robot, this gets a bolt going all the way through it, and inside here, that's kind of missing, is a spacer that would go from this hole to the opposite side of this hole on the sheet metal, so that we clamped all the way through this entire structure. So instead of having it just bolted up here where you might be able to bend something, it probably would have still worked because especially since we have this double reinforced up here, it's not just mounting to this one flange. But we wanted to be extra sure, and it also makes it also makes working out, it actually makes removing it a little bit easier because we're not having to deal with a nut or a bolt inside of here. We just have to get the spacer in the right spot and then put the full 4 or 5 inch long quarter 20, whatever it is, going all the way through. Similar to these sort of bottom pieces, there is a top piece that does part of what the bottom one does, but a little bit less because it's not mounting up the top, so it stops flat up there. But it does come down to give us a little like top structure and have a place for the side panels and everything to mount it, excuse me, to mount into. We were relying a lot on having some pretty precise bends because this top part and bottom part had to have their holes line up and match up at the front, right? So you had these three holes here and those three holes here. So we were requiring those to fit properly, which sort of worked. There were ones that weren't quite good enough that we had to drill out and they were off a little bit, but we still were able to get rivets in and make it work. And then you had side plates that were there basically to cover these outer sections on each of them. And they also actually had a flange down at the bottom, which is probably overkill. So these had a flange down here that we're able to mount in as well. I think what we eventually did was we cut through a couple of them. I think all the outer ones got like cut through. So then we just had this flat plate that act kind of like a cover that we could take on and off if we needed to. Once we realized we were going to have electronics in there, we wanted to have some way to get to them without having to disassemble the whole thing somehow, like drill out a lot of rivets. So there were like, there were riv nuts inside some of those flanges, in these back flanges where this would bolt to. Yeah, so back in this flange, there were a few places, I think there were like 4 riv nuts put in, and then we could bolt these covers on if we needed to. And I think for quite a lot of the robot, we just left them off at some point. Okay, what time is it? All right. Moving up to the arm. So this was actually probably the thing that we spent a long time trying to figure out how to do this well without welding or a lot of like kind of weird, like needing a rotary table on the mill possibly to get precise holes in some sort of like rotary pattern. Let me hide that part, that doesn't really exist. So how we were going to mount this arm assembly without having, because you can't have any sort of shaft running all the way through it because you have the extension moving in, right? So what that basically means is you have these outer plates here that sort of both clamp the whole thing. So you have bolts running through this. I think these are tapped. Oh no, it might be thread all. It's probably thread all. So yeah, we have thread all or threaded rod running all the way through these with nuts on both ends. So they kind of clamp the whole tube structure. And then there's also, I think there are rivets or bolts coming from the, in certain parts of it where we can, coming from the inside of this tube going to these plates or all the way through the sprocket and everything here too as well. Let me see if I can change some colors. Hard to see. Maybe not. Okay. I know why I can't change it. Okay, because it's all in the, everything's white, so you have to play with the luminosity setting, and I have to go through and do that for all of it if I wanted to change parts of it. Might be able to get rid of some parts of it. Can you guys see what the different parts are? Is it reasonable?
Yeah, it's not that bad.
Okay. So Right. So how do we do that? So what we were trying to figure out was there's not a lot of easy custom parts that have the sort of cylindrical pattern with a bolt circle. So what we ended up using were Vex Pro live axle Coulson hubs, or sorry, dead axle Coulson hubs. So let me show you what this part is. So how this is normally used was you would put on Coulson wheels, they don't come with any sort of hub or anything in there. So you don't have a way to either put a hex hub, or you don't have any way to put bearings in there to run on like a dead axle assembly, like you would on a kit drive or on our normal drivetrains. So what the hub is designed for is to put a 7/8 OD bearing with that can have like a 3/8 axle for like the kit of parts drivetrains. So you put a 7/8 bearing there, you put a 7/8 bearing here, and you put a 3/8 bolt running through it like you do on the AM1 for use. And then you can have a Coulson with a sprocket mounted to this outside hub part. And it lets you drive a Coulson wheel that way. So this would be pressed into a Coulson and that would work. So this had roughly the shape we needed, but we didn't have a good way to put this part into a bushing of some sort so that we could actually have it pivot. So we did on the lathe, we were able to make relatively simple lathe part that just started out as a 7/8 OD solid aluminum rod. And we turned down the face to be 3/4, I believe. Yeah. So this part is 7/8, and then this is 3/4. So this gets shoved through the live axle Coulson hub. It gets pressed all the way through. This part sits where the bearing is supposed to. The 3/4 part sticks all the way through out to the far end, and we're able to spin the 3/4 shaft inside this pillow block that McMaster sells. So this is just a part that you can buy in McMaster. It has a 3/4 bronze bushing on the inside here, an aluminum casing, and we can just bolt this on. And so that's how the arm's able to pivot, and we don't interfere with anything on the inside here. There was a lot of weirdness exactly like where bolts could be, because you had to make sure they weren't in the way of any bearings coming through, right? There's a little bit of a gap between the inner tube and the outer tube, which we'll be able to see at some point here in a second. But there's not a ton of room, and there are bearings riding on these walls. So for certain parts of it, you can't have anything mounted there. So there's places where you can, and there's places that you can't based on where the bearings are. Another thing, I don't know where that sprocket came from. That's confusing. That should not exist. Okay, there's only supposed to be one sprocket on this arm. It's over here where the arm gearbox is, which we're gonna talk about now. I guess we'll go backwards a little bit. So the big sprocket is a full, what is that? Some large 60 tooth. So this is a 60 tooth sprocket. So very large sprocket, definitely the biggest sprocket we've ever had on any of our robots. And so we didn't just use the bolt pattern from the Coulson hub. So we already had that, which was nice. And it let us use the Vex Pro Versa hub, kind of spacers, hubs, whatever you want to call them. So you actually get not only the bolts transferring some of the torque, you also get the plastic little Versa hub nubs, the part that stick into these cutouts. So you have those transferring torque through both of these applications at least. But you still want to have you want to have bolts, and you want to have load kind of operating at the edge of the sprocket, so you get a bigger lever arm. So having the bolts that we drill out here, so we kind of made, I'm pretty sure what we did was we routed a template that we could bolt to this bolt circle that the sprocket already had. And then we could just drill through on the drill press the holes that we needed for all of these exterior ones, and they'd be in the right spot. So this saved us a lot of bolts on the exterior that was actually transferring all the load to the arm, to the sprocket, without having anything try to bend or twist or do anything weird there. It's a lot easier on the sprocket if you can bolt it out to the outside. Okay, down here we had the arm gearbox, which is basically just a few pieces of sheet metal. So this is, this was 1/8 inch and bent. We started as just a single piece of flat 0.09. I think there was some reason why we forgot to add this bottom flange. I don't remember why. But when it was just 0.09, we ran it one day. I think we were at 1/18 practicing, right before bag day, back then. And we bent this thing quite a lot. Like, we started like popping chain, and we were really confused why. And it was because this whole plate was like squished out, and this sprocket was just way closer to this top sprocket than it originally started to be. Because this whole plate was basically able to fold since we didn't have this bottom flange down here, and it wasn't thick enough. So we went back, made it thicker, added the bottom flange. It's possible we could have gotten away with just adding the bottom flange and leaving it at 0.09. We weren't worried that much about weight, so it was easier just to err on the side of caution and just make it thicker and add the flange. The back part is just a single flat plate. It's not taking nearly as much load as the front. And so it just has standoffs mounting it to the front. And there is a large gear here, that's connected to the two gears coming off of the versaplanetary back here. Yeah, so that's an 18 to 72 reduction, which is a pretty common reduction. 18 is not the smallest size you can get anymore, because I think Westco sells a 16 tooth half inch hex gear. But Vexpro, I think, only sells an 18 tooth. So it's it's the common small size half inch hex gear. So you get that in 18. And then 72 is a relatively common gear that we've used in lots of different things and have on hand. So it's easy enough for us to drop that there. And then we had them built in to be able to have versaplanetaries, because we weren't sure what gear ratio we wanted in here. And we didn't know how fast we wanted to be able to make the arm. So it was easier to be able to mount it with versaplanetaries. We also catted it to make sure that we could add more motors if we needed to. We didn't. We ended up running both versaplanetaries, but with a single 775 Pro in each of them. And then one of them also had a VP encoder in it, so it was easy enough to put a encoder in the arm. So we were using that encoder to do our position control for the entire arm, was based on that sensor right there. If we were doing this season, it's very likely that this would be one or two Falcons or Neos, and we'd have the encoders built in from the motor. We would need less gear reduction, so we almost certainly wouldn't run it through a VP. We would probably have two stages of reduction somewhere in this plate gearbox to get us enough we need before we did the sprocket. Let's see. Yeah, so there was just a hex shaft going through here. The sprocket clearly wasn't just floating in space. I don't know where the cat for the hex shaft is. It's clearly just not here. Is it hidden or something? No, it just seems gone. Okay. Yeah, at some point there was a hex shaft there that was catted. Unsure where that is now. Okay. Yeah, so the rest of the arm is, the outer arm is basically two sheet metal parts. There's the outer large C, you can see here, which is a very large sheet metal part. So this includes some of the mounting for the extension gearbox, and then it includes places that we end up mounting no, we don't. There's just some top bearings and some stuff that end up being mounted up here. Okay. And the other part is just this top face that has two flanges on the side that just get riveted in here and along here. So nothing too crazy there. This top face has a bearing mount for the other side of this VP, so we can support the shaft here. So this chain is never trying to pull or twist this at all. And then at the top, one of the kind of odd things that we ended up doing was this is just the front of a VersaPlanetary. So there was never any intention to put a motor here or anything. This was just a simple and easy way to get a sprocket mounted cantilevered out here, right? So we're gonna have to like custom make our own bearing block that had two bearings in it and could support a hex shaft to hold this sprocket on it nicely. Or it may not even have to be bearings. We could have done something with a bushing and a half inch round shaft and some way to support and like turn down a hex shaft where we're spinning in bushings out here. Could have done a lot of things. This was the simplest, as we have VersaPlanetary components. It's easy to mount. It has threaded holes. We have the shaft pretty easy. We just had to cut one of the hex shafts so it didn't hit this interior spot. And it also left us some options to be able to potentially add VersaPlanetary stuff. So it's actually catted here with the VP ratchet assembly. So we weren't sure if we were going to need a ratchet or not for when we use the arm to climb. And so one of the thoughts was we could use the VP ratchet up here to do that. And when we were playing like the normal game, we would have it somehow like open most of the time. And then when we went to climb, we would engage it so that we would extend it all the way up and then we would release something. And when we pulled down, it wouldn't allow us to fall back to earth. We ended up never having that. It was always just the output block from a VP just acting as a bearing block. The inside of this and the inner stage is where things start getting a little awkward. So this has been updated to the IRI configuration that I think got built. I'm not even entirely sure if this actually ever got fully built. This part of the robot was probably not necessarily the worst, but definitely one of the worst. The basic goal was to figure out how to build this like carriage assembly where you have to get all these bearings in here to support the back of this inner stage so it's not riding on metal anywhere and it doesn't get all twisted or anything. And the original design for it, I did, and it was not able to be built. It was basically like this outer U and there was an inner U, but because of how the bearings kind of like stick out past here, you could never stick the inner U into the outer U when the bearings were installed. And I completely missed that. Like, we sent everything to production. We get it all back and we're like, and I'm pretty sure it was Jack who was like assembling it. I was like, Alan, what did you do? You designed something that's unbuildable. And I'm like, no, it's fine. I'll figure it out. And I like sat there and tried to force things to go through other things. And it clearly just never worked. So it ended up being some weird bandsawing and some drilling of secondary holes and things and some different like routed parts, because there's some Lexan spacers in here, to let us kind of mount everything and secure the bearings. And it worked for a while. It took some little bits of maintenance throughout the season. And then we I don't remember exactly when it exploded the first time, but at some point it just like exploded. It might've been, the one I absolutely remember having to completely disassemble it was the last match of the first day of IRI. So we were working through all of IRI dinner. We were supposed to be doing other things and like having fun. We were just like trauma surgering our entire arm apart and figuring out how to get something buildable and workable for the next day. Like we were shift, like we had full on shifts of who's going to eat when and like what was getting done. It was a lot of work to rebuild this whole interior thing, because we just somehow destroyed it at IRI. I want to say it got broke at some other event at some point, but I don't know if it ever got as broke as bad as it did at IRI. This final version worked a lot better. I want to say Jack did the redesign on this. And it was a lot better than my design by like a lot. had we figured it out earlier, we probably could have been able to design stuff into this a little bit easier. At one point there was like a 3D printed idea that was supposed to work that never actually took off. There were a lot of different ways to try to build this, and most of them were bad. This final version worked pretty okay. So the basic idea is you have this chain running the whole length of the arm, and it is mounted, so it's bolted in through here, through these bolts here. So as this chain moves, this back of the arm gets pulled up with it, and extends out of the robot, or extends out, and it takes the intake with it. So there's a plate in here that's mounted the whole way. That's the whole inner arm, but it's mounted to these intake plates. The top bearing assembly is a lot easier because it's on the outside, and kind of gets mounted with plates that come in, and gets bolted here. And there's just a shaft that runs across this that holds these bearings in place. So you can kind of pull this shaft and you can slide the whole inner arm out a little bit pretty easily by just pulling this one bolt that's here. Okay. Any questions on the arm part of the robot? Yeah. Hopefully very few games I think we would ever rebuild this again. Elevators are just so much easier. They get you more height. They're less complicated to have to do any of the internal rigging here or anything like that. I'm pretty sure we would be sticking to an elevator for almost any game that's similar. So intake. So there's a lot to look at in our blog on like intake design. We probably spent, I don't think we got to kind of this version of the lightning bolt intake till somewhere almost probably like 3 weeks into build season. We spent so much time prototyping intakes. We kind of knew we were going to be doing that because from kickoff, we were like, oh, we have to interact with this cube that we've never dealt with before, right? The last cubish thing from 18 was sort of the totes. So a lot of people look back at the 2015 game to get some idea of how to do it. And there are some robots that definitely took direct inspiration, right? One of the big ones was a triple helix that year, was inspired kind of by 1114's 2015 intake. And they built an intake that several other people used too after they published. And we were kind of moving down a different road for parts of it. So we knew we were kind of in this weird constraint in that we had to be able to have it be vertically symmetric, because we needed to be able to intake from, or wanted to be able to intake from both sides of the robot, right? Had to be able to flip over an intake too, was the goal at least. And we also were doing this very weird and honestly very bad thing of intaking at an angle, right? So as this comes down, these wheels aren't flat to the ground, right? They're pointed up at this angle with the arm. But we needed the cube ideally to sit flat against this back plate so that the pneumatic punch that was mounted inside of this would be able to punch the flat part of the cube and launch it up on the scale, which is how the design we were going for. So that meant not only did the intake have to like grab it, it had to take a cube from any like sort of flat orientation ideally and get it to rotate to where the wheels are on flat sides and like slide up and pivot itself kind of up this corner of this intake thing. Instead of just coming in and getting reoriented, it had to like pivot up. So this is definitely a harder challenge than a lot of teams' intakes had to do. And that led us to doing a lot of intake work. The version before this, that kind of led us there. Let me see if I can get it up on the blog real fast because it's useful to know where this kind of came from. Let me flip to the browser. So basically we had this like virtual four bar that had a lot of belts. Like you have these two motors, then there's a belt going to the pivot, and there's a belt going to this pivot, and there's a belt going to here, and it's all over these, and there's a lot of belts happening. And so, like, kind of the idea here was that it would grab at whatever angle and it would sort of suck itself in and right itself, which should kind of work because part of we were also, you had this other orientation of the cube, right? The cube isn't actually a cube. It is a rectangular prism. Two of the dimensions are the same and one of them is not. So we are having to figure out how do you play with that? Like, how do you build compliance in to be able to grab that other orientation? So we kind of had this thing that was sort of working. And when it was stored back, it could be all the way back to here. So there was some thought we could like completely clear out of the way to be able to do the punch thing. So that's kind of where we're going with it. Basically what we figured out, let's see, I think it's one of the ones kind of right after that. So we kind of figured out as we were tuning in and getting the four bar correct, this is kind of where it wanted to live. It didn't really want to live straight. It kept living in kind of this like angled gap thing right here. And we realized once you had this, we didn't have to do anything else to the intake to get it to spin around because this corner had enough room to be able to like rotate basically. Like one of the wheels would grab the corner. And because you had this sort of like you left room here, it could do what it needed to reorient itself. And that was kind of the big advancement that was kind of the big takeaway from all of this work of like this thing took forever to prototype. We would kind of be able to get like a new version every other day because one whole day was taken just like assembling and disassembling this thing because of all the different belts and everything that went in. But yeah, so we figured out that, oh, okay, if you do this thing, it works better. This is also a puncher test at some point. So once we realized that, that's when we were like, oh, okay, we can do this intake a lot simpler. We don't need all this four bar stuff. So we ended up just getting to here, and this is kind of basically where the intake stayed, right? There were a lot of little tweaks from here. There was actually, after we published it, other teams started using it, and they actually tweaked it and developed stuff back to us. So 319 was probably one of the biggest ones, Bob. Their versions had the pivots in different dimensions on the pivots and different proportions. And I think we eventually used part of theirs to drive our design even further later in the season. But once we were here, right, you could just make new ones of these plates over and over again. And depending on how you could change the pulleys and belts, you could change all of the configurations of this intake a lot for whatever we needed it to do. Does it do its thing? Yeah, so you can see it actually working. And so we were able to drive it in right on that corner and have it rotate the way we needed it to. One of the other big things we figured out, which took a while to figure out, was having two different grippinesses or durometers, like how grippy each one of these wheels were or how compliant these wheels were, helped a lot as well because one side would want to grip over and spin the corner better than the other. So if you didn't do that, you would kind of get the same as both sides were trying to pull in this cube. Both sides would equal each other out exactly, and the cube would just stay centered. If you had one side that was grippier than the other, it would win, and it would be able to rotate the cube around like this one. Basically, the white wheels are much grippier than the blue wheels, so it wins. It goes around the corner and kind of pushes this to slide a little bit in the other direction. Okay. Back to CAD. I was gonna say this is our first year of doing a lot of what we call mat joints. They're also called finger joints with either cross nuts or anything like that, however you want to call them. But basically, you have the slots for the piece of polycarb to go in inside the outer one, and then the bolt goes through. These were done in actually kind of a loud knock on my door or next door neighbor's door. These were done in a way that I think 148 did for part of their robot that we like kind of copied, not realizing that they're slightly inferior to a much simpler way where you just have the slot be hole and then you have a hole somewhere where you put the nut on here. It gets a lot stronger. You're not like pulling through this little bit of plastic as much. and you don't have a square hole for your bolt, you have a round hole that the whole bolt can seat into nicely. Yeah, so we've changed to our default pattern. There's still times where this makes sense. If you don't have a lot of room, you can do this. But where you can, it's a lot easier to have the hole be separate. And you have like three bolts with two slots in the middle or something like that. You get a much stronger joint that way than the way we had been doing it. It was kind of the first year we built anything to that, this level of stuff that way. We used it, the entire intake is built that way, right? It's the construction method for basically every single panel. Even a bunch of the standoffs, we started routing and bolting in instead of doing like actual standoffs or anything like that where you have to tap something. You can just do the plates there and it's nice and easy. Especially now, this would have been so much faster in 2019 or 20 when we had the laser cutter, where we could just be turning these out very, very quickly. The router wasn't too slow, but it was definitely slower than what the laser could do. Let's see. Yeah, so the motors aren't actually in this version for some reason, which is weird. But basically the motors were here. They were mounted on VPs, I believe, and they were just belted over somewhere. There's also like a second, there's a second pulley. So there's a pulley here to this top one, and then this middle one drove to there and then to there. This one is printed because it has bearings on the inside. So this is a standoff, basically that's just a dead axle. Since all this is doing is rerouting the belt, it doesn't need to be on a hex shaft or anything. So it's just printed with a couple bearings in it and a small, I think 3/8 shaft going through, going from plate to plate and a bolt going all the way through it. These are the, why am I blanking on the name of the wheels? Fairline rollers. These are the white Fairline rollers that we used for similar ones to what we used for like our shooter in 2017. These are compliant. They're called like Durasoft from them. They sell a couple different durometers of these as well. They're a little bit more complicated than normal FRC wheels in that you have to put a hub into them. They come with like the steel core, but they don't have any way to attach a hex shaft. But you can buy them that the inside diameter is 1.125, which is the same as any bearing and also like the VersaRoller hubs. So we would put VersaRoller hubs into them. We would use like green Loctite retaining compound to glue them in place. So they couldn't come out at all. So we'd have these nice, nice grippy wheels for our intake. Let's see, last parts of the intake. So these gas springs here were a good idea in theory. They ended up taking a lot of maintenance because we would bend them all the time. But basically what they let us do was they let us drive the arm into, we had little Lexan plates here that actually had little, bump switches down here so that when these hit, we would know the arm was fully down and they would also spring. So if we overdrove the arm, we would have to collapse these gas springs before we broke anything, which worked okay. But then if you like caught them on anything or anything, they were just kind of like floating out near the arm. So they were a little rough to be able to do that way. Probably wouldn't do that again. We'd probably figure out some other way to stop the arm. The original plan when we were designing this, when the concept was that they would be mounted, the gas springs would be mounted to the robot, so they wouldn't move with the arm. But every version of that never worked right. Like we could never find a mounting that actually we liked or anything like that. There's probably a way to do it, we just never got there. What else? Oh, the thing that never got catted because we just built it is the punch, which is the last part of this robot. I don't know where even the best, if there is a good blog post for that. It's probably the best. Okay, so there are some photos. I think we went back and eventually took some, but what's actually fully in the arm, I don't think ever really got done. But basically, if you go through our advanced pneumatics guide, we kind of lay out what parts we use for this. But we had to go through and figure out, okay, how do we get the most air into a pneumatic cylinder as fast as possible to be able to use it as like a catapult, to be able to use it as a launcher to launch the cube into the scale. So we had to find the solenoids that had the largest flow rate. So depending on the solenoid you use, when it opens, how much air can get through it the quickest. There are rules about how the number that can be, basically. Or there were. I have to double check if there still are. And then also, how do you have air stored there that you're not having to pull air through a regulator? Because the regulators slow you down quite a lot. Like they're designed to like let pressure through, but they're not allowed to let a lot of air through very quickly, which is not what they're designed to do. So what you end up doing is inside of that inner telescoping arm, we have two pneumatic cylinders with two solenoids mounted directly to them. So you actually have like brass fittings. There's no tubing involved between the solenoid and the cylinder. So this is what's controlling the air. When we send an electrical signal to this, this lets the air go into the cylinder, but there's no tubing in there because the tubing restricts your flow a little bit too. The fittings have a little bit bigger of an opening. So you use brass fittings directly. And then right behind that, each of these solenoids have their own air accumulation chamber that sits behind them and basically just fills up with air and waits for you to fire the punch. So once you fire the punch, all that air from the stored cylinders goes straight into the cylinders, and you get a nice big launch out of it compared to what most people do, right? So we have some test footage of it going pretty high straight up, right? It ended up getting like 8 or 9 feet, I think. So that was kind of part of our idea of being able to play on the scale longer, was to be able to launch cubes up. That was less good because you actually need a lot more finesse when you're putting cubes on the scale than we had, because we were just launching them, where you really want to be able to place a cube directly if you want to be able to build a nice tall stack. So that was another design flaw that we probably should not have done. I think that basically finishes the robot. Oh, there are no hooks on here. So these plates had plates sticking through that allowed us to have a little pneumatic cylinder out here that would flip up a hook. And that's how we would climb. We saw it kind of earlier in the video. I don't know where the hook CAD is. So eventually this version is what's currently on the robot, because we got rid of them because the robot doesn't climb anymore. But somewhere there is hook CAD that you can go through, and basically it just pulls a cylinder and the hooks flip up. We definitely had issues with that we redid multiple times throughout the season, because there would be times where like they didn't hook right or where they would get bent. We definitely could have had some sort of better concept and better location of how to put them too. We needed so much reach past the intake to be able to climb, just in the way our design ended up working, that it never quite got to what we wanted it to be. Okay, any questions about this robot before we switch over and do 2019?
Did the intake ever like cause us, like when we were climbing, to like fall, or was it never like that bad?
I don't remember a time where we fell. Most of the time it was always just, if it was broken, we would just wouldn't get hooked on. Mm-hmm. It was definitely more annoying too, because the way we designed it, you had to like drive on from the side. So that meant that you had to like, it was weird for depth perception too, to be able to actually get the hook up and on. They're also just like Lexan beams. So every once, like we broke a couple hooks at some point. I don't think we did it while we were climbing. I think they happened at other points. But they might've snapped while climbing during like the off season or something. But yeah, it was not the best. It was not the best climbing robot by far. It definitely didn't climb for certain parts of different events. It worked pretty well as a switch bot. It was okay. It did go to IRI, but it did not play in Elims at IRI. And it was good enough even at the scale to like win Alamo, right? So we did win on a regional with it. It was okay. It got outclassed at Champs. We ended up being a fourth robot at Champs who did not play any limbs at Champs. Our alliance only made it to the quarters, but we likely weren't playing any during it anyway. But we did well enough at champs. I think we were ranked like 10 or 11 coming out of quals, but then somehow just didn't get picked for a variety of reasons, right? I don't think this robot never had a scale auto, so we couldn't put a cube on the scale during autonomous at any point, partly because of the all omni drive made path following very weird, and partly just because of what, like, the space we had, the bag came into some of that, and not having enough time with the competition robot to be able to get it to work. Practice field time, a lot of stuff went into not having a scale auto. Any other questions?
Why did we choose to go four wheels instead of like six or eight?
Oh, so once you're all omni, there's no reason to have more than four wheels, right? So like the six or eight wheels allow you to turn when you have traction, right? Because you're able to have drop centers and you can shorten up your wheelbase. Once you're all omni and you have no scrub, there's no advantage in having an extra wheel. One of the reasons we actually did do and intentionally chose to do all omni and do four wheel was because of the cable bump that was in the middle of the field. So to be able to run power to the scale and the switches, there were these cable bumps that came in directly centered from like the scoring table and stuff midfield that crossed to the scale. And there were cable bumps that crossed from the scale to each switch. And the original design for those were these very hard plastic cable bumps. And if you were running those, they were basically almost acted like the steel berms from this season. Where like if you took them at full speed with a six or eight wheel drive robot, your robot would like get air. Where with a four wheel drive robot, your front goes up, you land back down, you travel a little bit, your back goes up, you land back down. Right at the end of build season, they realized that the cable protectors were breaking. So they swapped them to these nice flexible soft ones that you could have drove anything over and you weren't gonna ever jump. It was actually one of the bigger field changes that they probably ever did that no one really complains about because no one quite realizes what would have happened with the harder ones. Like the harder ones would have broken pretty regularly, which would have been a disaster for the field. So it was a good thing they changed it. But it also would have made a lot of robots not happy when they drove over them at full speed. Like they would have just not been able to drive over the whole length of the field nearly as fast as they could with the softer one. I think there's video somewhere of like the Everybot team driving over the hard one and like getting a pretty good amount of air. Because they're just taking the kitbot over it at like full speed. Any other questions? Okay.